Welcome back again, our wonderful guest, Cece Murphy.
We feel we have to explain God and make God logical. I can't comprehend God, so how can I explain God's motivation?
Welcome to Heritage of Truth. Today, I would like to welcome back again our wonderful guest, Cece Murphy. How are you doing?
Oh, great. It's always nice to be with you.
Thank you. Well, you have two new books out, I Believe in Healing and I Believe in Heaven. Now, tell me what made you want to write, especially this book, I Believe in Healing.
Well, a couple of years ago, I was at a writer's conference, and Steve Lawson, who was an editor with Recall, we were talking, took me to dinner, and we talked about healing, it's a great story, because my wife had a wonderful, wonderful healing experience. We were involved in a car accident. She was not expected to survive. They let me stay in the emergency room with her, and 4 days later, she actually got up and walked out of the hospital totally healed. So anyway, I told him the story, and he had a new story, and about a month later, he called me, and he said, we're talking to the folks here, and they want to do a book on healing, and they want to call it the Healing Book. And I said, that's a kind of dumb title. And he said, what would you call it? I said, I Believe in Healing. He said, that's a great title. So so they said, would you do a book? And I said, well, I have a personal assistant, Twyla Belk, and I'm trying to help her get into the writing game. So I said, if Twyla can work with me, we'll do it.
All right, and Twyla did work with you on both of these
books.
So why don't you tell us, for example, does healing truly happen today? Obviously, you did with your wife.
The theological climate in this country has been, our last probably 100 years, is that healing stopped at the end of the first century. So here's the way I say it. There's a beautiful word, one of my favorite words is called recrudescence, which means a kind of popping up, something's dormant, kind of pops up. So if you look at the Bible, there are three periods of miracles. The Exodus, Elijah and Elisha, and the New Testament. And then, they say, well, Paul wrote the last word, he left Trophimus ill at Miletus. And they said, see, he stopped healing. I said, my answer is, no, he didn't heal Trophimus, but didn't mean he stopped healing. So what I did is we did a couple of things. We started looking historically to find stories. You see in there the stories, and some of them are dated. For instance, there's 1911, but we go back to some of these, 1870, 1181, 1624.
Wow.
So what I want to prove is, see, this recrudescence happens. It'll just kind of pop up. And the best way to see it in this country is around the turn of the beginning of the 19th century, the 20th century, there were revivals, we called them, all over the world. The Welch Revival in 1904, the Azusa Street in Los Angeles, the Philippines, Rwanda, South India. There was all this kind of awakening. T.L. Osborne went to Africa in the late 50s. And revival, healing, that sort of thing broke out everywhere all over East Africa. Kenya, and I lived there a few years later, but Kenya, Uganda, and Tanzania, it was called Tanganyika then. And so this keeps happening. And the charismatic movement put a lot of emphasis on healing, and people were getting healed. And I think this is the climate. People are open now to spiritual things.
Well, that's good. So You talk in your book about healing and how it happens, and you give lots of examples of healing, including the story of how God healed my voice. So I know from experience that God heals, and he does it miraculously. So can you tell me just a little bit more about what you were trying to do with this book?
Yeah, I was trying to answer questions. See, there's some people who believe in healing, and they say, everybody gets healed. If you don't get healed, there's lack of faith. And see, that's not the point. Number one, God doesn't owe us anything.
No.
And anytime somebody gets healed, that's an act of God's mercy and love. Third thing is that some people actually have a gift to heal. My wife had this not all the time, just occasionally, she would feel such real compassion for somebody, and she'd lay their hands on them and pray for them, and God would heal them. Mm-hmm. I could probably tell you 10 times that I know of that happened. She didn't become an evangelist to go out and try to heal people. She never felt that's mm-hmm. where it was. But see, a gift for me is something God gives you and uses it whenever God chooses.
That's right.
But I think anybody can pray for the sick. James says, call up the elders of the church. And that's one way of doing it. I think that's the best way of doing it. But anytime somebody's sick, look, you're my friend. If you see I'm sick, would you pray for me?
Absolutely, I would pray for you.
And you know what? God just might say, okay, Jean, I'm going to heal him because you prayed for him. Mm-hmm. That happens.
Yeah. He's sovereign. He gets to do what he wants. He's God.
That's right. And see, we tend to limit God, or we try to find answers for God. Mm-hmm. You mentioned when we were off camera that about some people think everybody ought to get healed. If you don't get healed, something's wrong with you.
Or with your faith.
Yeah. My daughter, older daughter, was going to a church, and she asked for prayer for her husband. And the pastor prayed for him. They believed in healing in that church. And nothing really happened. So the next week, she asked for prayer again. He said, no, we prayed once. That's all you have to do to God. God either says yes or no, and that's it. And my daughter was horrified. She said, well, what about the stories about importuning? He said, not for healing. Anyway, you know, the point is that God does heal. I have no question about that. Does God always heal? Again, I have no question. The answer is no.
Right.
Look, Jean, if God always healed, everybody become a believer. This is a sugar daddy God. You know,
yeah.
Just you're sick, get healed. And if you go out and sin, well, you get, you repent, then you come back and get healed again. You know, that kind
mm-hmm.
of thing. So, and see, I think one of the problems in our culture is we feel we have to explain God and make God logical, and I can't comprehend God. So how can I explain God's motivation?
No, we can't. And a lot of times when we look back in life, we can see why he allowed some things to happen that didn't seem good at the time. But afterwards, you look back and you think, I'm so glad it did.
Yeah, you know, mine isn't a physical story, but I'm a survivor of sexual abuse. I went through a lot of years of pain. I really did. And you know, it still keeps coming. But here's what I want you to see. I'm at a place now where I look at verses like Romans 8:28. We know that all things work together for good. See, a lot of people think that just means everything's going to turn out happily. No. What it means, I believe, if you read the rest of it, it says, goes on to say, to be conformed to the image of his son.
That's right.
And so what I call it is I reuse my pain. In other words, well, you've been in some physical pain recently.
Mm-hmm.
Now you understand it. And because you understand pain from your own experience, you now have more compassion, I assume.
Yes, I do.
For people who are in pain. That's the way God works.
Mm-hmm.
Paul had a thorn in the flesh. We don't know what it was. It may have been his eyes. It may have been, who knows? It doesn't matter. But Paul also says in 2 Corinthians 1, I think it's verse 3 and 4, he's in essence, he says, the comfort we receive God from God, we can now turn that around and give comfort you.
Mm-hmm.
See, so to go back to what you were saying, is sometimes you go down the road and you say, okay, I don't understand all this, but I do know that I now can feel the pain and the hurt of other people because I've been there.
That's right. Yeah, that's definitely right. Now, do you think that people experience sickness because of sin?
Absolutely. I don't think we can always say, you did this, therefore you...
Well, mm-hmm.
And you know, we know now, for instance, people who smoke,
mm-hmm.
you are asking for cancer, emphysema, heart mm-hmm. condition. We just know that's so clear now. We can make those direct correlations. What we fail to realize sometimes is when we mistreat our bodies, overeating, not mm-hmm. exercise, and so on, and it comes out 10, 20 years later, we don't always make that connection. And it's not my job to make that connection. I don't think that's not what the point is. And there's some people always trying to find out what your sin is before they can pray for you.
Uh-huh.
Well, see, here's the way I feel. I feel that you're sick and you're hurting. I care about that.
Mm-hmm.
And I will pray for you.
Mm-hmm.
And then I will say to you, or hope you'll say to yourself, is, okay, God, what do I need to learn from this? See, I think we fail to take into consideration, the Bible says the body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. Now, let me give you my own example. I was a pastor, and I was hospitalized twice with an ulcer. Fortunately, I didn't have to have surgery. I didn't have any exercise. I ate anything, you know, all that. And after my second time, my doctor said, "Congratulations, I want to see you regularly." He said, "You've got high blood pressure. It's coming up there. You've been hospitalized with ulcer." And he said, "You're going to become a regular patient." As I walked under, I prayed, "God, please help me never have to go back." I never did. Mm-hmm. But here's the verse that came to me. Paul wrote, "Whether therefore you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God." And that brought a lot of conviction to me. And I'm not trying to lay this on anybody else. I think unless God speaks to you, it's not your verse. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't lay that verse on anybody else. This is my verse from God, God's mm-hmm. word to me. So I started changing my lifestyle. I got into an exercise program. I'm not fat, but I was a little heavier, about 25, 30 pounds heavier. And that just sort of fell away. God. And, you know, I've been so much healthier. I've never had any other problems, physical problems since then, because I've tried to take that very seriously. I've honored God with my body, and God has honored me with good health.
Okay. But then how about when someone's born with an illness? When someone's born with an illness or handicap or something like that, obviously that's not because of sin.
Yeah, well, you know, the disciples asked Jesus, John mm-hmm. chapter 9.
What, right.
See, the idea then in those days was, you know, if you're sick, it's because you sin. And then they went on so far as to say, if your parents sin, you can be afflicted in the womb.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I don't understand it, but look, I do believe that somewhere there is a cause for that. So mm-hmm. my job to find out, you know, people who are born with these various illnesses, look what we do to our world and, mm-hmm. you know, people who breathe in toxic air and so
right.
on. It's going to, if it doesn't affect you, it may affect your children or your
right.
grandchildren.
That's true. Mm-hmm.
So, but see, I just don't believe in going out on a search party to find out who sinned or who failed. What
right.
I believe in is to say, God loves you.
Mm-hmm.
And because God loves you, I'm going to ask this God of love and mercy if it would please him. That's my key. If it would please him to heal you. And then it's mm-hmm. up to God. And I don't have to justify one way or the other. God says yes. My job is to pray and ask for your healing.
Right. And to have compassion.
Well, I mean, that's,
right.
yes. Oh, yeah, Jean, sure.
Yeah. I mean, I've learned that so much, you know, from my own little bit of experience with pain, that, you know, that compassion and showing that you care really does make a difference.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and there's a sense of healing in that, you know, at least emotionally.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, tell us a little bit about I Believe in Heaven.
Okay, well, because I Believe in Healing did so well,
mm-hmm.
it, well, I mean, it hadn't been released, but they loved the thing. And see, I designed it.
Oh,
they
wow.
just wanted the stories. And I said, you know, I had to have the theological, biblical stuff. And see, again, as I said earlier, I went back through history and documented. Well, with heaven, you know, I did a book in 2004 called 90 Minutes in Heaven, wrote
right.
from Don Piper, and it kind of started this movement.
Mm-hmm.
And there, how many books are there out there on heaven now?
Yeah.
Any number. And not that that's bad. That's fine. So Twyla Belk and I got to work on this, and we collected stories from people. We did the near-death experiences. These are people who, it's a real formula, and it goes across cultures and across the centuries.
Hmm.
They die, and they go through usually a dark tunnel. There's a light at the end. They want to stay there. And the voice, somebody, either Jesus or an angel, somebody says, "No, you have to go back." And then they whisk back, and mm-hmm. the doctors say, "Oh, she's alive." Whatever. That's
mm-hmm.
that's a typical near-death experience. That's
mm-hmm.
one. Second kind of, there are a few instances, people who feel they really died. Don Piper's one.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't have any of that tunnel light and so on. Apostle Paul went into the third heaven. We have another one of an African who was dead for 7 days, and then
and then
came back to his body. So there are a few stories like that. The third kind of stories we've had in here are what we call nearing death awareness.
Mm-hmm.
These are the people who know they're going to die, and they see angels or Jesus or something. Here's my favorite story, and it's included in here. My friend Stan Cottrell's great-grandfather was dying. Mm-hmm. He was in the bed, ready to, I mean, it looked like he was going any minute. Mm-hmm. His whole family was gathered, and he sat up. He looked at him and started talking, and then he just kind of turned around and said, "Just a minute, Jesus, I'm not ready yet." And he finished telling his, isn't that wonderful? He finished telling people, the family, what he wanted to say, and then he said, "Okay, Jesus, I'm ready." He dropped back. It's gone.
Oh, my goodness.
See, but it's because they have this extra sense that the mm-hmm. angels are there. I'm a former pastor, you know, and I was a part-time chaplain for about 10 years. I used to hear a lot of these stories. Sometimes they would tell me things. They'd say, "Last night an angel came to me and said I was going home soon." Mm. And it's not a thing of despair. It's kind of a joyful thing. Yeah. So we have all these kinds of, so those are the kind of stories we did in I Believe in Heaven. And then I try to do is get the document about it. What does the Bible really say about heaven? Mm-hmm. See, there's so many stories about heaven. You know, some of the questions, like, here's the one I hear all the time. Are there dogs in heaven? Will my pet be in heaven? My answer is, I have no idea, and I don't think anybody else does either. Mm-hmm. See, one of the things we have to remind ourselves that dogs were not domesticated in biblical times. They were mm-hmm. scavengers. And to be called a dog was one of the worst insults possible.
Yeah.
So here's the only way I can look at it. God loves us, and whatever we need to be a perfect, it will be there. That's the only way I can say. Another issue that comes up is, okay, what happens when you die? Do you immediately go to be with Jesus, or are you in the absence, the son is called soul sleep? And there's a lot of debate about this. The big problem to going immediately to heaven is this. Are you to get rewarded before the great judgment? That's fine. But what about the other people who we believe will go to hell? Does that mean they get punished before the judgment? Or they're in some kind of holding pattern that's still a form of punishment until then? Or does it mean that there's an absence of life until the moment of the resurrection and everybody comes alive? And the answer is nobody really knows, because you can make a case for either one in the Bible. It's not really clear. Mm-hmm. And you know what? I don't have to know. Do I?
We really don't.
See, because either one of those positions, what it means is, if I die, my next conscious moment would be the resurrection. I will be with Jesus. So what if it's centuries pass and there's no life, and but the next moment, that next moment of worth, I'm with Jesus. Mm-hmm. See, it doesn't matter to me.
Yeah, it's kind of like Fanny Crosby said, the first face she will see is Jesus. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, really cool. Because, you know, she was blind.
Yeah.
And so the very first face she would see would be his. That's exciting. Well, do you have anything else you'd like to share with our viewers before we close?
Well, see, I think we're in a place where our culture is really a mess. Everybody knows that, you know, and the morals have gone downhill. So, and deny that. But I think that's also the time when God comes around and says, okay, now I'm going to do something. If you look at the book of Judges, you've got seven cycles in there. Mm-hmm. God bless them, they're in the land, everything's going great, they begin to get easy, take it easy, and then the Midianites or somebody else comes in and overwhelms them, the Philistines, and then they suffer, they cry out, oh God, save us, and then God sends a leader, and they're rescued. And they go along for a while, and bang, it happens again. Well, I can't prove this, you understand. This is my thinking. I think we as a nation need to get desperate. Hmm. And when we get desperate, that's when God will come and send a renewal, awakening. And if you look historically, cultures go through phases. And I think we're ready for some new intervention by God.
Mm-hmm. Well, it seems to me we certainly need, the people of our country need to turn back to him, especially the believers. We need to be confessing our own sins, confessing our nation's sins.
And living the life.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And you see, I think we also forget that there are places in the world where to be a Christian is to be suspect. I just met two women a couple months ago, about a year ago, who came from Iran, Christians in Iran, and they were in prison for almost a year just for believing in Jesus Christ. Sometimes they're killed. I lived in Kenya, the fanatical Muslims would kill anybody, come in and raid them, kill anybody who was a Christian and refused to recant.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, there's persecution going on all over the world. But, you know, the persecuted church is a strong church.
Of course. Yeah. Origen said blood of saints is the seed of the church.
That's right. That's right. Thank you so much for being my guest. Tell everybody where they can find you online.
Okay, just my name, CecilMurphy.com. I spell Murphy with an E-Y, but even if you misspell, it's okay. www.CecilMurphy.com.
Okay. Thank you for being our guest again.
My pleasure, Jean. Thank you for having me.